Hello, students of science. Let's talk about your musculoskeletal system. As the name implies, it's a little bit to do with your muscular system and a little bit to do with your skeletal system. These two systems work together to help you move. A musculoskeletal system has to generate force and apply it against air, water, or land, depending upon what organism we're talking about here. We have three types of skeletons that we're going to be talking about. The first one is going to be the hydrostatic skeleton, which is essentially water pressure inside an earthworm. Second one is going to be an exoskeleton, something you'd see like the shell on the outside of a snail, or Tony Stark's Iron Man, that'd be an exoskeleton as well. Or finally, the endoskeleton, that's what we have, where you have bones inside your body. Let's get started on that. So, hydrostatic skeleton. More or less here, you have fluids held inside a cavity. As the name implies, this has to do with water, and this allows organisms to alter their body shape drastically by contracting different cells. An earthworm is a great example of this. They don't have a skeleton per se, but they do have a hydrostatic skeleton. There were no bones, but there still allows movement. By contracting circular muscles, it's going to push various segments forward, and then those little bristles called the setae are going to anchor the segments and prevent it from sliding backwards. Constriction of other muscles will pull up the back, and the cycle repeats itself. Advantage to a hydrostatic skeleton, they're flexible. They can get into just about any opening, and they never need to worry about essentially anything being broken. Disadvantage, of course, dependent upon water. Earthworms, in particular, are dependent upon water not only for their skeleton, but also for their respiration. They need to breathe through their skins. Examples of this are going to be Hydra, and no, not the enemy of Shield. I'm referring to actually these little pond animals here called Hydra with the tentacles and the body stalks. Very cool video right here. I'd suggest you check out about their lifespan. Hydra are earthworms, organisms that have a hydrostatic skeleton. Another example is the exoskeleton, the external skeleton made out of a hard material, like the Iron Man machine, if you will. The advantage to this, in a lot of organisms, it provides watertight physical protection. It's going to protect them from all the stuff on the outside, and they don't need to worry about losing water as well. Big advantage to that. Disadvantage, of course, it's heavy. Arthropods, like insects, have to molt in order to grow. They can't just get bigger because they've got that external exoskeleton essentially protecting them, but also preventing them from growing. So they have to break it in order to bring out the new skeleton that they have on the inside. You can see another example of a cicada, which is going to molt and essentially get rid of its old exoskeleton. Examples of this: insects, spiders, lobsters, even clams have a type of exoskeleton, if you will. So some shrimp, an earwig, scallops, or mollusks. Here you can see molting with an exoskeleton. Poor guy. Now, endoskeleton, which is of course what we have. Here you have a support system inside your body. So there's our human endoskeleton. And most endoskeletons are made out of a hard substance like bone or cartilage. If we're talking something like a shark, they don't have bones, or calcified plates, something like a starfish. They don't have a skeleton in the same way that we would think. They don't have bones, but they do have these very, very tough, very calcium-infused plates. Here you can see a fish. They, of course, have an endoskeleton. Advantage to this, it can grow with the body. Here we see an example of a pregnant cat, and you can see all the little baby kittens inside her right before they're going to come out. That skeleton they have is going to be the same skeleton they're going to have for their entire life. They never have to shed it. It's going to grow with them because it's living tissue. It's not just a hard substance, it's living tissue going on inside there. Disadvantage, of course, if you've ever, experienced the joy of a paper cut, there's no external protection. I mean, if you're a bug, you never need to worry about getting a paper cut. Granted, if you wanted to bigger, you have to molt. So, there's problems either way, but the endoskeleton does not have external protection. Examples of this, of course, humans, fish, starfish, lots of different organisms that you're very familiar with. Great comic here. I definitely would recommend you pause it and watch that. And joints. Now, if your skeleton was just a single piece or the parts were rigidly attached to one another, movement would be impossible. Arthropods and other vertebrates can only move because the many body parts are connected by joints. Here you can see an example of a knee joint, and here we have different bones, and they're loosely connected. They're not rigidly connected to one another, and this allows for some freedom of movement. There you can see the joint in the elbow. The different bones there have freedom of movement. Here you can see the ankle, a lot going on down there, but again, they're not rigidly attached to one another. Here's your hip. You can see that that one's actually twisting as it goes because it's a ball and socket joint. And then we have, of course, the many, many joints inside your hand. Now, all these bones here are going to be connected to each other by Ligaments. Ligaments are these flexible, strong things that are going to hold bone to bone. They don't allow for movement. You know, they're not there to move the bones. They're just there to make sure that the bones are connected to one another. The tendons are what actually are going to be connected to the muscles. More on that in just a moment. Really cool video here of an animal called the Japanese spider crab, and you can see the jointed limbs that it has.
Each leg is a tube down which a strand of muscle runs. The muscle is attached to a projection from the next joint so that when the muscle contracts, the joint moves. It's rather like the arm of an industrial crane which has an outer network of steel girders down which a wire hawser runs. Of course, the one sort of joint you can't put on such a system is a ball and socket joint, which gives a sort of universal movement that I can have in my shoulder or my thigh. But the crab deals with that by having each of these joints working in different planes, so that one way or another, it can reach almost anything that is within its immediate neighborhood and convey it with its pincers to the mouth, where it's chewed up in these mouth parts. Its body is protected by this heavy armor of shell, and the crab can tell what's going on around it because through the armor they project tiny little sensory bristles. This feature is indeed spectacular, but every now and again from the waters of this bay, the fishermen bring up a real giant, and creatures like this are over 11 feet across.
All right. Now, your muscles, as I mentioned, are going to be attached to bones via tendons. And muscles usually don't just work on their own. They have a pair, one to extend, one to contract. Here we can see an example in both an endoskeleton and an exoskeleton. You're still going to have those flexors and extensors. Now, your flexor, also known as your hamstring, it contracts and it pulls your leg back. Your extensor, your quad, when that contracts, that's going to pull your leg forward, like if you're kicking a soccer ball or something like that. These two have to work together. Even though they're working in opposition, they're partners on this, and they have to work together in order for you to have coordinated movement. Now, insects are going to have the exact same thing. They're not of course, going to have hamstrings and quadriceps, but they still have flexors and extensors that allow them to create movement via these muscle pairs. Good example of this, your flexor, your hamstring, and your extensor, also known as your quadriceps.